see my slides.
Yeah.
Great. So, start. So this is going to be, I'll be taking you through hematology malignancies. So during the week, you had been told that you're supposed to prepare this topic, on this topic. So it's basically a revision series. So I'll have a set of questions, then I want it to be as interactive as possible. You give me your answers, your thoughts, okay? Then, yeah, so we can discuss together. So I can start. So what do you guys see in this picture? You can type on the chat, you can unmute. Lytic lesions, yes, dark blots. Okay, so this is a radiologic image. So let me see the questions. So describe the abnormality in the skull. So basically, just describe what you see. I've seen someone has said lytic lesions, yes, you can see some dark blots here. Yes, What is this? What is this organ? Yeah, so this is a skull, okay? So when you're describing, there's a certain way we describe this. So you say they are lytic lesions. We also call them punched-out lesions, okay? And they're distributed across the skull. You can see here, one, two, another one here, another one here, another one here, okay? So punched-out lesions or the lytic lesions distributed along the skull, okay? Then the next one, state one hematological condition associated with such an abnormality. It's very distinct for one hematologic condition. Multiple myeloma, yes, excellent. This is the punched out lesions of multiple myeloma. Then name three tests for diagnosis. There are quite a few, so I'd like you to mention them. Serum protein electrophoresis, yes. When you mention serum protein electrophoresis, you have to remember also the urine protein electrophoresis. Yes. And the normal tests that we do, CBC, yes, urine protein electrophoresis, yes, PBF. Bates-Jones protein, yes. So it's a certain test. I think you've done it in clinical chemistry or during your practicals. Yes, or bone marrow aspirate. Yes, quite a few tests. Okay, then four clinical features of the above condition. Four clinical features of the above condition. Bone pain, yes. So remember when we say bone pain, it's usually the most common bone pain they have is usually back pain, okay? Basically backache. So you'll find that these patients have when they have like the back pain, they'll it lead to vertebral collapse. And when vertebral collapse, we call them pathological fractures, okay? So bone pain, there's usually a formula I have for clinical conditions, but you can, yes, crab. Crab. So what is the C? C is hypercalcemia, yes. So when you say hypercalcemia, you have to mention. You have to mention the features of hypercalcemia. Okay, so renal failure, yes. So, and then the A is anemia. And the B is the bone pain, yes. So anemia basically mentioned the symptoms of anemia. There are also some more that you're going to see. Great. So here are the answers. So a raindrop skull appearance of multiple myeloma, multiple well-defined lytic lesions or punched-out lesions of various sizes scattered throughout the skull. This one we have said it. So it's called the raindrop skull appearance. Then one hematological malignancy, so multiple myeloma. Then the three tests we have is urine protein electrophoresis, UPEP, which we expect to find. We expect to find presence of paraprotein, IgG, IgA, and light chains. Then serum protein electrophoresis, which we expect to find the paraproteins. Then the Bradshaw test, as I had said, where you find the Benz-Jones protein. Then when you do a BBF, you expect to find Rouleau formation. Who knows what Rouleau formation is?
Yeah.
So Rouleau formation is stacking together of the RBCs. Basically, they clump, look like coins, okay? And then we have ESR is really high. Then a complete blood count, we expect anemia, so low RBCs. Then in advanced cases, we might have neutropenia or thrombocytopenia. And then a BMA is done, we find abnormal plasma cells, okay? For clinical presentations, as we said, the formula is crap. The C was hypercalcemia, features of renal failure and/or hypercalcemia, polydipsia, polyuria, anorexia, vomiting, constipation, mental disorders. And then we have bone pain, which has explained backache, resulting in vertebral collapse, pathological fractures. Then features of anemia. So when you say anemia, you have to explain that there'll be the symptoms of anemia, okay? So lethargy, weakness, the ones breathlessness, dyspnea, okay? Then recurrent infections related to deficiency in antibody production, abnormal cell-mediated immunity, and neutropenia. Okay. And then we have. Then we have abnormal bleeding tendencies. The myeloma protein may interfere with platelet function and coagulation function. Okay. Then amyloidosis occurs in 5%. Features such as macroglossia, carpal tunnel syndrome, and diarrhea. Mild fever, night sweats, weakness, weight loss. These are we call them the B symptoms, which are very vague for many malignancies. And then risk of petechial bleeding due to thrombocytopenia. Okay. So if you ask this question, mention the crab features. Okay. Then I'll go to this one. Stage two conditions that can present in such a manner. So first of all, what can we see here? Okay, I'm seeing a question. Can we include complete metabolic panel in the test to detect the features of multiple myeloma, e.g. the UVCs? Oh yes, because it presents with renal failure, you will have to do the urea electrolyte and creatinine. So we're seeing gingival bleeding, mucosal bleed, yes. So which two conditions can present in such a manner? We also see some conjunctival bleeding.
Look.
Yes, for acute leukemia. So which one? So which two conditions? So we have AML and ALL, okay? Acute myeloid and acute lymphoblastic leukemia, okay? Then three test tissues for diagnosis as your differentials above. So which test will you use for differentials here? Yes, flow cytometry. Yes, so cytogenetics, yes, so flow cytometry. What do you expect with flow cytometry? Sorry. So flow cytometry, as someone had mentioned, flow cytometry basically differentiate between B cell and T cell ALL, okay? And then cytogenetics, yes, this is call them chromosomal analysis, okay? Cytochemical staining, yes. Do you remember the stains we use? Okay, so you can see. So we said it's AML and ALL. Then the useful tests, cytochemical staining to differentiate AML from ALL, flow cytometry to differentiate B cell and T cell ALL. B cell ALL, what are positive markers? CD10, 19, and 20. You have to remember this. And T cell ALL, CD3, especially CD20. You have to remember that. Then BMA. Yes, we expect a hypercellular marrow. Remember when defining leukemia, usually say 20% or more of blast cells in a bone marrow aspect, okay? And then chromosomal analysis, there'll be translocation at age 21, this is ML, okay? Yes, okay. Then we go to the next one. Okay, what is this? Okay, so the questions are, an 8-year-old girl with abnormality shown, what is the abnormality? So what is the abnormality? Seeing someone is asking PBF. Yes, a PBF should be done. Remember when we do the PBF, we're going to see the blasts, which are the abnormally large cells. Yes. What is the abnormality? Burkitt's lymphoma, Burkitt's lymphoma, Burkitt's lymphoma. Yes. So Burkitt's lymphoma is not the abnormality. Remember, they have not asked the diagnosis, they have asked what is the abnormality. So it is a mass, or you can say a dual mass, okay? So you have to be very keen. Okay? What is the abnormality? It's a jaw mass, or mass of the jaw. Okay. Now they've asked at least two possible diagnoses. Now that is where you can put your Burkitt's lymphoma or any differential. So what are your differentials? We know Burkitt's is the first one. Any other two differentials? Metastasis to the jaw, yes, but I'd like to know which malignancy are we thinking about. So rhabdomyosarcoma, yes. I'm sure you did the namings of the malignancy in back in your second year. So rhabdomyosarcoma. What do we mean by rhabdomyosarcoma? We know it's a sarcoma, meaning it's malignant. But what is the rhabdo part? So yes, so rhabdo basically is, you know, a malignant, okay, a cancer originating from the soft tissue, and in this case, myo is the muscle, so it's the muscle, so it's a malignant growth from the muscle. So rhabdomyosarcoma. Then we have osteosarcoma. Yes, osteosarcoma can also be a differential. Any other one? Nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Okay, for nasopharyngeal carcinoma, will it be at the jaw? Do we expect nasopharyngeal carcinoma at the jaw? Or will it be at the nasopharynx? Should be around here, but this is more a jaw, so Burkitt's lymphoma. Yes, I think those are more than two. I have a question for you. What about if someone says ameloblastoma? Do you think that is correct? Ameloblastoma? Yes, so ameloblastoma is not correct because we expect ameloblastoma to be cut adulthood, okay? Can a swelling of the parotid be a cause? Okay, where is the parotid located? Like, for example, in this patient, we expect the parotid to be around here. Okay, the patient is the clear view, but it should be around here. So the parotid, you'd expect a swelling to protrude from here. Like in mumps, have you seen mumps, how it looks like? The swelling is usually here, but you can see here, the jaw is here. Okay? Or here, here's where the parotid is. Okay? But this one you can see clearly it's from the jaw. Okay? Then set the test for definitive diagnosis. What do you use for definitive diagnosis of this? If a patient came, what would you use for diagnosis? PBF, no. PBF is not the definitive diagnosis. Biopsy, yes. So biopsy and fine needle aspiration. I don't know, have you rotated in pathology? I'm sure you've seen these FNAs being done. So I have a question for you. So let's see the next question. Before we go to the regions in Kenya where this patient is likely from, for example, if we were to do a biopsy and we saw How would we know it is Burkitt's lymphoma? There's a certain pattern we'll see on microscopy that I'm looking for. Starry sky appearance, good, excellent. See starry sky appearance, we know that is very obvious for Burkitt's lymphoma, great. And then the next question, regions in Kenya where this patient is likely to come from. So where is Burkitt's lymphoma prevalent in Kenya? In fact, this question is, it came during our essays last year. We were to mention, I think, four regions in Kenya where we'd like you to find it. Western Kenya, yes. Western, so Nyanza, and the coastal region, great. Bungoma, yes, Bungoma is Western. So, just confirming, so we said subjomas, Burkitt's lymphoma, rhabdomyosarcoma. So you'd say osteomyelitis, it was a slightly smaller mass, but this one, it was big. Metastasized neuroblastoma, fibrosarcoma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Remember, Burkitt's is part of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Okay. So when you say non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, it's kind of vague, but still a point. Because remember the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, it was classified. Do you remember the classification in terms of aggressive and low grade? We have the follicular lymphoma, hairy cell leukemia, Burkitt's lymphoma, mantle cell lymphoma. So if you say non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, it's kind of vague, but they'll still take it, then osteosarcoma. Then here, note, ameloblastoma is mainly seen in adults. Okay. Then test, core biopsy, and then FNA is a screening. Then you said the regions are coast, western, and Nyanza. Okay, good. The next one. So identify the cell. Myeloblast, great. So remember, we said identify the cell, not the pathology, okay? And remember, you might get confused. As much as you're seeing the arrow rod, you can just rush and say AML. So the cell is a myeloblast due to the arrow rod, this one. Then give one disease condition, AML, and then give three classical presentations of this condition. The three classical presentations we expect in AML. So, bleeding, yes. So, I prefer you say increased tendency, because remember, okay, the three features we have are thrombocytopenia, neutropenia, and anemia, okay? So you're looking, in thrombocytopenia, you have increased tendency of bleeding, okay? Because you have decreased platelet counts. So that is the first feature. Number two, in neutropenia, what do we expect? Recurrent infections. So you're easily going to get infections. And then the third one we have, anemia. Because in RBCs, you have anemia. So you'll have features of anemia. Remember, don't mention anemia, just mention the features of anemia. Easy fatigability, dyspnea, you know, pallor, breathlessness, all those, okay? then list three investigations in this condition. I mean, there are so many, so can you list them? Anyway, you see a hematological question. Don't forget complete blood count, peripheral blood feed, bone marrow aspirates. Those are the most common ones. So what do we expect to see in a PDF? These myeloblasts, okay? And then complete blood count, we expect HB to be reduced, WBC count to be reduced, platelet count to be reduced, okay? And then in a BMA, what do we expect to see? Cytometry, yes, as you had mentioned, cytochemical staining, blast cells in a BMA, good. And then cytochemical staining, we had mentioned above. Which ones do we use? We have the esterases and Sudan blood would be positive in AML. Sudan blood be black, and then periodic acid. The PAS, periodic acid, the Schaffer, it will be negative. And then the acid phosphatase will be negative, okay? Yeah, so you have to know that because they can ask you to list the four cytochemical stainings used to differentiate AML and ALL. Okay? So, AMLoblast, AML, then we said reduce RBCs, reduce neutrophil, and reduce platelet. RCBC, PBM, bone marrow aspirate, cytochemical staining. Then we go to the next one. What is the question? Identify the cell pointed by the arrow. This one and this one. And then identify the neoplasm and stellates cell marker. So what kind of cell is this? A smudge cell, excellent. What neoplasm do we see? Very specific to smudge cell. CLL, excellent. What's the cell marker for CLL? What's CLL cell marker? While at it, I want you guys to tell me a characteristic finding in a patient with CLL. There's one finding you will see in a patient with CLL that you will almost diagnose them with it. As much as they have the B symptoms, as we said earlier, the night sweats, fever, fatigue, weight loss, they have a very characteristic clinical feature. Splenomegaly, not really. Splenomegaly is more of CML. In fact, splenomegaly, in CML, they have massive splenomegaly, very massive spleens. Black nails and teeth, no. Lymphadenopathy, yes, that's the answer I was looking for. For lymphadenopathy, first of all, in a patient with CML, they usually don't have lymphadenopathy. But in a patient with CLL, these patients, you interact with them when you when you start doing your ward rounds in internal medicine, you'll see them. We describe them as walking lymph nodes, because you'll see they have so many lymph nodes, so many lymph nodes that are actually, there's what we call them lymphadenopathy. Increase in size, they usually large lymph nodes all over the body, and they are painless. Okay? So we call them the walking lymph nodes in CLL. Then the normal ones, the B symptoms, and then walking lymphadenopathy. So don't forget that. And then obviously the reduced all the cell lines, anemia, thrombocytopenia, and neutropenia. Okay. So if you're to differentiate between CLL and CML, remember the lymphadenopathy. Okay. So what was the, did we answer that question? It's cell marker. What's the cell marker for CML? CLL, sorry. CD19, CD20. So basically, the B cell markers, CD19, 20, 23, okay, CD5, yes. So CLL positive for B cell markers, CD20, CD23, okay, great. So don't forget that walking lymphadenopathy and B cell markers. Next one. An adult male with immunosuppression and progressive nodular lesions in the lower limbs. Biopsy taken at histopathology shows spindle cell neoplasm forming vascular channels and extravasation of red cells. Regression noted at the start of air. If you see spindle cell neoplasm, what do we think about? What do we think about? Even if you weren't given this image, what is our likely diagnosis? Yeah, they gave out the answer on the description. Kaposi sarcoma, excellent. So there are three things that we know of Kaposi sarcoma that you most likely find on histopathology. Number one, the spindle-shaped cells, the vascular channels and extravasation of red cells. So basically that is formation of new cells. And then we usually have leukocyte infiltration, okay? So you have to know that. When a biopsy is taken in these ones, you will see them, okay? And for these patients, if a patient comes with Kaposi sarcoma, what do you think of? Like if a patient comes with this satellite, you think of HIV, okay? It usually occurs when CD4 counts as less than 500, okay? Kaposi sarcoma can present in other ways. So you see these papules and nodules in the skin, they can be everywhere. As much as they're in the leg, they can be on the neck, on the face, on the gums. Okay? They can be everywhere on the skin. So today, they might bring this image or any other image. But remember, it's very characteristic of Kaposi sarcoma. And the three biopsy results that I've mentioned, the spindle-shaped cells, leukocyte infiltration and extravasation of red cells. Okay. So HHVA, we don't have this bias, it. Then what is this? Name the cell shown in the lymph node biopsy. So this was taken from a lymph node. What kind of cell is this? What is the associated disease? And the test is useful for diagnosis of the disease. First of all, before you identify the cell, what appearance is this? What do we call it? What appearance do you call this? All eye appearance. Okay, great. So it is the Reed Sternberg cell. Great. What is the associated disease for Reed Sternberg cell? Sorry for the break. Hodgkin's lymphoma, yes. Great. This is Hodgkin's lymphoma. Two tests useful for diagnosis of this disease. I told you, anytime you see pathology question, I mean the obvious ones. Complete blood count. What do you expect in complete blood count? Yes. Blood count, we expect reduce RBCs. WBCs be reduced, yes. And thrombocytopenia, okay. And then any other test? For Hodgkin's lymphoma? Lymph node biopsy, yes. So we did biopsy, and this is what we found. Good. Finding classification, yes. Immunohistochemistry, yes. LFTs, yes, because remember these patients may have hepatosplenomegaly. CT scan, yes, radiological imaging, yes, CT scan, X-rays. So for X-rays, we are interested in X-rays because it may affect the mediastinal lymph nodes. So that's why we do the X-rays. Yes. Then the non-specific tests, LDH, ESR, CRP, yes. Those are non-specific, basically for inflammation. Yes, so all those tests. Check if you've mentioned all. So, Hodgkin's lymphoma, Reed Sternberg cell, biopsy of involved lymph nodes, immunohistochemistry, bone marrow biopsy. Should be bone marrow aspirate, and then PET, CT scan, chest X-ray, if any. Okay, then this one, name and identify the cell shown by the arrow. This one. What cell is this? So I want you to identify what cell this is, these ones, and I want you to identify what cells these are.
Yeah.
What cells are these? Okay. So the first on the left, plasma cell. Yes, so it's a plasma cell. Why do we say plasma cell? So you look at the nucleus. You can see the nucleus is at the periphery of the cell. Can see this is the cell outline of the cell. Here is the nucleus, and then look at the color of the nucleus. Okay, it's bluish. Is it bluish? I don't know. Bluish, purplish. And then you look at the cytoplasm. Look at the cytoplasm of the cell. It's completely. It's like slightly pale compared to the nucleus. So that is a plasma cell. Okay. That is a plasma cell. So during sport, these images, you only have 1 minute to see these images. So you have to train your eyes to know, okay, this is a plasma cell. I'm sure you've done those other types of cells, the basal fields, eosinophils, monocytes, leukocytes. I was not the one doing it, but whoever is going to take you through should show you how to differentiate them. But you have to train your eyes to know them, okay? And then, what are these cells here? Ones are pointing here. RBCs, yes. So you can see these RBCs, they are, as we had mentioned earlier, the Rouleau formation. Usually stacked up. Can you see them? Like coins. So that is what we call the Rouleau formation, okay? Inflammatory disorders associated with an increase in the number of the cell, so increase in the number of plasma cells. So basically, I want you to name the plasma cell disorders. So we have multiple myeloma, the most obvious one, multiple myeloma. And another one, we have, yes, Waldenström macroglobulinemia. Okay, that is just overproduction of the IgM. Okay, and then we have MGUS, good, MGUS, let's call it MGUS. Monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance. Okay? So we call it undetermined significance because it's really overproduction of any Ig type. Okay? And what is special about it is we don't have the normal clinical features, the Krabbe finding, hyperglycemia. Renal failure, anemia, and the bone pain. Okay. And then which other one? MGUS, yes. Plasma cell leukemia. Yes, plasma cell leukemia. Then I have a question. Which conditions will you see the Rouleau formation? This Rouleau formation. Two main ones you'll see the Rouleau formation. HIV and multiple myeloma. Okay. Those are the most common ones. Diffuse large cell lymphoma. Never heard of it. It has the Rouleau formation. Maybe you check, but I doubt. DiGeorge syndrome. plasma cell. The Jones syndrome is not a plasma cell disorder. I'm seeing DI here. What is that? Someone has texted DLBL. Maybe you write in full. Oh, diffuse large B cell lymphoma. So for DeGeorge, you know, DeGeorge, you're taught in immunology. DeGeorge is it mainly affects the T cell, which is a T cell immunodeficiency, isn't it? We usually don't talk about its we mentioned the clinical features, but for biopsies, it doesn't affect. Basically, DeGeorge, we have, we usually call it the 22q11, is it 11? Deletion syndrome. There's a deletion at chromosome 22, okay? So this is not associated with hematology. It's an immunology deficiency syndrome. Okay? I hope you understand that. Yes, T cell deficiency due to thymus defect. Yes. Okay. We are done with that. So, plasma cell, as I explained, nucleus towards periphery, nucleus, cytoplasm, cytoplasm, mean nucleus is pale, and then prolonged formation. Multiple myeloma, plasma cell leukemia, found in circulation. Then older stroke, macroglobulinemia, peripheral gammopathy of undetermined significance, and then HIV. Okay. So identify the above. So this one, it actually came in our exam. And I remember when I was seeing this image, I was confused. I could not see any issue with this pattern. So I was looking for 1 minute. I'm like, can't see the pathology here, but there's an actual pathology. What can you see? I want you to look. Here are the cheeks. Yeah. Here are the nose, the cheeks. Yeah. Plethora, yes. So it's facial plethora. Can you see? This guy is slightly red. I mean, to me, he looked normal when I was doing my exams, but he's slightly red. So there's that facial plethora, okay? And then identify the causes. So in facial plethora, we can divide them into two causes. There's the primary cause and secondary causes. But what is the primary cause of facial plethora? Polycythemia vera. Good. And what about the secondary causes? Secondary causes of facial plethora. So when you guys are looking for the secondary causes, we can maybe mention about polycythemia vera. What is polycythemia vera? We know polycythemia vera is where we have an increase in RBC disorders, isn't it? Increase in RBC number, okay? So what do we call these diseases? They're called myeloproliferative disorders. They're usually three. Where we have an increase in numbers of the cell lines, WBCs, platelets, and RBCs. Maybe you can mention, we have already said polycythemia vera. What about for the platelets? Essential thrombocythemia, yes, ET. I mean, never write that in the exam. But in the exam, avoid short forms unless they are short forms that are globally known. If you write ET, what is ET? It's not a globally known short form. If you write CBC, which is okay, CBC, PBF, but if you write ET, you know, so it's essential thrombocythemia. And then for WBCs, what is the myeloproliferative neoplasm for WBCs? What do we call it? CML, isn't it? Yes, good. So we have CML. CML, essential thrombocythemia and polycythemia vera. Okay. We also have another one. But now for this one, we have, we call it myelofibrosis. So for myelofibrosis, the bone marrow is replaced with fibrous tissue. And there is a appearance on the RBCs. It's very specific to myelofibrosis. What do we see in RBCs of myelofibrosis? Teardrop, excellent. The teardrop RBCs, great. Okay, I've gone through the myeloproliferative neoplasms. We're talking of secondary causes the facial plethora. So one here, Cushing's. So is it Cushing disease or Cushing syndrome? You have to be specific. Because if you write Cushing, you know the disease is different from the syndrome, isn't it? So it's Cushing syndrome, okay? One, you guys are forgetting over transfusion. If I transfuse too much disease, what will happen? You'll have this facial plethora, okay? Then another one is also COPD. SVC obstruction. So it's very common, but I can quickly look. Superior vena cava syndrome. So this one, you have venous congestion on the head, neck, and upper extremities. Yes, it can present with facial plethora. So that is also there. So you'll add that. Okay. I'm not audible. Am I audible right now? Someone was saying I was not audible. Okay, you can hear me right now? Thank you. So superior vena cava syndrome can also be there. Then identify the test can be done for the above patient. Complete blood count, yes. What do we expect? We expect, what do you expect in complete blood count? Similar question. Is cyanosis common due to reduced partial pressure of oxygen? Polycythemia vera. So in polycythemia vera, we know we have an increase in RBCs, isn't it? So why should cyanosis be common? What is the pathophysiology of cyanosis? Cyanosis is when you have decreasing oxygen to the peripheral tissues. You know, the types of cyanosis we have, the peripheral and central. So if no oxygen goes to the limbs, is where you get the peripheral cyanosis in the fingers and the toes. And for central is around the mucosal area. Lack of oxygen perfusion, isn't it? Okay. So, do you expect cyanosis in polycythemia? Something to think about, you can go check, but at least I've explained the pathophysiology for polycythemia. Okay, we were talking about the tests for polycythemia. So we said complete blood count, peripheral blood smear. There's one genetic test that you haven't mentioned. Jack, yes, Jack2 mutation test, which is common in polycythemia. Yes. Increased blood viscosity, I'd say yes, depending on severity. Yes, unless you can give me your reasoning on how you're taking it, but can see it making sense. When blood is more viscous, you get blood not reaching the peripheries. So it's hyperviscous, so low perfusion. Yeah, you can have that. Okay. So one thing to mention, you might be brought this picture, and then the question can be, apart from facial plethora, what do you expect in such a patient with polycythemia vera? Any other symptoms you expect? There's one specific symptom that you should know. Aquatic pruritus. Great. So in this patient, I've never met a patient like this in the world. They tell you they will itch. They will start itching, especially when they shower. So after showering, they will start itching. That is the aquatic or aquagenic pruritus. Okay. And then the non-specific symptoms. So you can imagine they can have, yes, hypertension due to increasing blood in terms of quantity, yes. Then the constitutional symptoms, the PC loss, weight loss, fatigue, sweating, you know, those ones. headaches, early satiety. Yes, those non-specific symptoms. Okay. Splenomegaly, yeah, we can also get splenomegaly. Hemachromatosis. Hemachromatosis. So, what is hemachromatosis? So there is excess, there is iron deposition. Isn't it? It can be on the skin, on the eyes. Usually it's as a result of increased iron absorption, isn't it? They have high levels of iron. It can be a complication. Okay, I think we're done with this question. So, facial plethora, polycythemia vera, presents with acogenic pruritus and erythromelalgia. I'll show you a picture of erythromelalgia. Then over transfusion of blood, COPD. And then we have, in CBC, we have high hematocrit, PBF, JAK2 mutation test, and red cell mass test. Why do you have a high hematocrit? First of all, what is hematocrit? What is hematocrit? These definitions should be in your fingertips. What is hematocrit? Pack cell volume, PCV. So basically the amount of red blood cells in a volume of blood. Okay, so for them, we expect them to be high since we have overproduction of RBCs. Okay, so this is what we are calling the erythromelalgia. Can you see the fingers, the arms slightly swollen, and the feet? Okay, okay. Identify the abnormal cell. What cell is this? That is this. Is this an eosinophil? No, it's a neutrophil, yes. So this is a neutrophil. So I think I should take you through how to identify cells. You know, the neutrophils, the eosinophils. Yes, this is the answer I was looking for. Pelgar wet. This is called the Pelgar wet. So if you see this neutrophil, it is bilobed. Can you see? This is one lobe, another lobe. You can also write a bilobed neutrophil. Okay? Look at the nuclei, it's bilobed. Okay? So this is the abnormal cell, you can say Pelgar wet or bilobed neutrophil. Bilobed nuclei neutrophil. Okay? Name the condition associated with this abnormal cell. Very specific for one syndrome. Myelodysplastic syndromes. Excellent. Myelodysplastic syndromes. So, maybe to mention, I think this is my last slide. Yeah, this is my last slide. Maybe to mention, what is myelodysplastic syndrome? I think you've done it. What is myelodysplastic syndrome? I mean, there are a lot. I know there are a lot. The multiple lineage dysplasia, single lineage, the one with excess blasts. Yes, there are many. So the primary one, primary MDS, myelodysplastic syndrome, the cause is usually unknown. But for secondary, you can have, you know, benzene exposure, chemotherapy, radiation. So a group of disorders affecting single or multiple cell production in the bone marrow. Yes, excellent definition. So if I was to summarize it, I'd say it's a stem cell disorder causing ineffective hematopoiesis, okay? So you'll have a defect in the cell lines, okay? So it can be the red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets. But the most common is the RBCs, where the most common feature in this myelodysplastic syndrome is anemia, okay? And over time, this myelodysplastic syndromes, they progress to now the leukemias, as someone has mentioned there. It progresses to AML. Okay, this is my last slide. Yeah, this is my last slide. So, let's stop here. I've tried to go through as many hematological malignancies as possible, especially the common ones you'll be asked during exams. So if you have any question, you can ask in the chat. I'll send the slides, and yes, any question? So there's a document compiled with my friends and I. For those who hadn't seen me. So people call me Netrono, but my name is Nathan Drono. So there's a document my friends and I had compiled last year when we were devising. I can send you a link to the document where we also have the ANAT Patho, KNKM, immunology, so that you start reading as early. I don't know when your spot is, but I remember it was usually around June or late May. So it's good that you have started early. Make sure you go through all these questions, engage with us. We are here to help you. Okay, there's also a YouTube channel where I did some recordings.